Yo, so here we are, episode number 6, the Drop-In Podcast. Absolutely delighted to be sitting across from Rab Wardell, who is a good friend of mine, but we've not been spending a great deal of time together due to the old lockdown restrictions. But yeah, welcome to the podcast, Rab. How's it going?
Thank you very much, Duncan. It's a pleasure to be here.
Nice. I guess the best way to kick things off is to talk about a pretty insane challenge that you've done recently and obviously introducing yourself to everyone listening. Like, so would you want to give us a little bit of a background of who you are, what you do, and what you've recently accomplished?
Sure, yeah. Well, I'm Rab, from Glasgow, bike rider, cycling coach, and I recently rode the West Highland Way, which is a off-road trail in Scotland, 96 miles ish long, and I rode that in 9 hours and 14 minutes. Made a pretty cool film with Cut Media, Wahoo in Santa Cruz, and yeah, it's been pretty mental, to be honest, the last little while, with all the reaction off of that. Comments have been real good, and yeah, it's been pretty sick.
Yeah, it's class. It was awesome to watch. I watched it a couple of times yesterday. It was such a sweet film. I've always been down in Wales, so it was quite cool to see Scotland in all its kind of glory. But yeah, you mentioned the West Highland Way. For those people who aren't listening, it's a 96-mile ride from Glasgow up the west coast of Scotland all the way to Fort William.
Yeah, so it's predominantly, like, it's mostly a walking trail, like a hiking route. But obviously we've got lovely land access in Scotland, so you can ride your bike on it. You can even ride a horse on it if you want. But it's an off-road route. It's made up of like ancient routes, like military roads, drovers' paths, all that kind of stuff. And it takes you right through the West Highlands and Glencoe and Kinlochleven and up to Fort William. It starts from Mulgay, just to the north of Glasgow. And it's meant, you know, I walked it in 2007 over 6 days. And when I was walking, I was like, man, this would be so good on a bike.
Yeah.
So I've ridden it a couple of times, actually. I rode it for the first, I didn't actually know anyone who'd ridden it before. And I rode it in 2011 and just over 12 hours.
Okay, cool.
And I came back little over a year after that and rode it again for charity. So raise money for Cancer Research UK. Yeah, kind of left it there for a little while. I kind of set records both those times, I think. Cool. It's quite hard to kind of like validate these records. There's no one really keeping a track of it. So
yeah, that's one thing I'm not really too familiar with, like these sort of like records and what you call like fastest known times.
Yeah.
What is the sort of difference between a record and a fast known? Is it just kind of basically keeping yourself covered in case someone kind of like calls you out or something? Is that case just because it's not really like a typically done thing, or?
Yeah, I guess because it's not, there isn't like an official log really, or like there's more websites that are keeping an eye on these things. Yeah. And FKTs really, or like the term fastest known time really comes a lot from ultra running.
Right, okay.
So yeah, more websites and, you know, I guess with like more technology as it's starting to, you know, once we've got like Wahoo GPSs, these kind of stuff, Strava, all of these sites that you can log rides and routes and stuff on. So there's like an element of trust in there. Like, you know, it's not, you know, there's, you're just kind of proving what you've done off of what you've done.
Sure.
So it's like, it's kind of reminds me, like I saw a film a little while ago, actually, and it was about mountain biking starting years and years ago, like in like the 80s or the 90s.
Right.
I'm talking about mountain bike racing, and they were like, the interviewer's like, did you have rules like back then? He's like, oh yeah, we had one rule, don't cheat.
Yeah.
That's kind of like the whole kind of vibe of this, is like you just kind of go out, do your own thing, register your time, and
cool. I guess with like you say with Strava and stuff like that, there's kind of, obviously you could still do it with like a motor or something cheap, but not really too many ways of getting around it. But, and you obviously had a film crew we'll obviously get to after. But how did the whole, you obviously say you've done it before, how did it come about this year? Has it been quite long in the sort of planning, or was it a case of, did it come down because of lockdown, or was it kind of a challenge out of that, or?
Yeah, like it's, like as, well, you've known me for a number of years now, so like I used to race World Cup cross country. I've been like an endurance rider, if you like, all my adult life as a teenager as well. It was like all what I've always done. And then like the last 5 years since I stopped racing World Cups in 2014 and kind of focused on my coaching career, and just like in terms of my own riding, it's always been like, you know, I rode some enduro for a couple of years, and I've been riding BMX tons and you know, skate parks and all that kind of stuff. So my fitness has been, I guess it's dropped. Mm-hmm. And then like through, went, moved into a new house with Katie, you know, probably tail end of last year, and got like a pretty sick like bike room set up with mm-hmm. my trainer and all that kind of stuff. So getting into that and like really getting, you know, noticing I was getting fitter. Yeah. And then we hit lockdown, and I'm living with Katie, who was training.
Yeah, probably worth sort of mentioning to everyone that your partner's Katie Archibald, who's a Olympic gold medalist, track cyclist. So
So she's a 3-time world champion. She's won, she's won a lot of bike races, and she's so I'm living with her in lockdown, and she's training. You know, the Olympics hadn't been cancelled by this point, so she's like training for Tokyo. We're going riding together. We've got a gym set up at home, and we just totally got like a lot of people, I think, just got really stoked on. You know, they're like, you know, just embrace the kind of the challenge. And I just started getting fitter and fitter. And I was like, man, I'm maybe, you know, starting to think like I could probably be as good as I was when I was like full time.
Yeah, okay.
And I had the idea to ride the West Highland Way. Like my time got broken in 2015 by Keith Forsyth. He totally smashed it. There were a few things happened, like the path kind of, I think there was a few upgrades to the path, so it rode a little bit faster. And like he's an experienced endurance guy, like he's won loads of 24-hour races, all that kind of stuff. And yeah, he smashed out of the park. I was like, Jesus, when I saw that. And I was beginning to think like it was, actually like my attention to detail was not great. I thought it was 10 years ago that I set my first record. I think it was actually 9. But my idea was like, 10 years, like 10 years on, go back and try and break 10 hours. Like right, I was like, well, that's quite a nice little thing, you know?
Yeah.
But I started speaking to a few people about it. So Ross Barkley at Red Bull was really supportive at the start, and that really started to just get the ball rolling. I was like, man, you know, maybe we could do something cool with this, maybe make some, you know, have a bit of a feature or make a film. Pitched it to Wahoo, and yeah, they were all over it. They loved
that's
it.
Cool.
Once that happened, and we kind of agreed it, and you know, having that little, you know, I say little bit of a support, a huge amount of support behind me from Wahoo, took that to Cut Media, and then it just started to snowball really.
Yeah. Okay.
So that probably didn't happen until, let's say June or July, once it started, and we actually set a date. But it's been in my mind for a little while.
Yeah.
You know, it's like I've kind of, I guess like daydreamed about it, like, oh, I'll go and do this. So like in the film, I say it's been a year in the making, but I guess really it's been maybe 3 months, like 3-4 months in the lead up to it was really smashing it.
That's cool. It sounded like you had like a kind of good, you'd got yourself like a good sort of base fitness. And then I guess once you kind of knew what was going on, you then just kind of ramped it up from then, I suppose.
Yeah. So like, I mean, I say like my fitness goal, but I've always been able to kind of just drop into races and stuff. So I've kind of been, I guess I'm kind of lucky that I can get my, you know, tune myself up in a couple of weeks. And so like last summer, that was like, again, having been riding with Katie a fair bit last summer, I was like, I'll ride the Scottish Road Race Championships.
Okay.
And I was out in Switzerland working for the UCI. And let's say it was like July or something. And I took my road bike out. So I'd like be coaching on the velodrome during the day with the developing athletes that we had there. And then at night, I'd go out, smash up some mountains, go ride up the calls or whatever. Yeah. And I basically did like a 2-week kind of like panic training, boot camp, if you like, and then came home and rode the Scottish Road Race Championships, which was pretty hard. And like I came like 19th or something.
Cool.
But always like kind of just, I'm able to just like, I guess, previously I'd done like short, intense training blocks, and then I would ride a race or something.
Yeah.
So I did, some cross-country racing and stuff. And yeah, I always kind of like to stay pretty active.
Yeah, that's interesting that about like the whole fitness thing. Do you think like physiologically, do you think it's almost like because you've done so much training in the past that you still, your body kind of just like still has that sort of, I don't know, that sort of like ability and like memory, or do you think it's quite a lot just down to like the psychological side of it where you kind of just know you can do it or you've done it before? In terms of like the actual performance as well as like the training itself,
I think there's definitely a combination of the two. You know, like I've been riding a bike since I started like cross country riding when I was about 14 or 15. Yeah. So mountain biking. And I've, you know, over that time, like there have been points where I've stopped and mm-hmm. like when I first walked the West Highland Way, I totally stopped racing. I came back from riding the Commonwealth Games in Melbourne and then I rode the rest of the season, but it was a bit kind of, I guess a bit like, disillusioned or a bit disheartened at how the mm-hmm. rest of the year went. And I just was like, you know, just took a break basically mm-hmm. for like a year or so. And then like reversibility definitely kicks in. Like you just kind of like use it or lose it. Like if you don't train, you will lose it eventually. So mm-hmm. it's not, you know, I guess you'll always have like the mental side, like the confidence of being like, well, I've done this before, I can go and do it.
Yeah,
and
for
like,
sure.
I think when you ride mountain bikes, like you kind of learn how to suffer as well a bit. Like you always go in like a group ride or go ride something and I don't know, like don't eat enough and totally. Yeah,
I think that's one thing I've learned from like riding mountain bikes. It's like what I said before, is that you do see that you might be out riding with someone who's like maybe let themselves get out of shape or whatever, but they've obviously done, like they've been fit before and that seems to still stand for something.
Yeah.
Like, and they'll still be able to sort of fire up the hills or maybe struggle up the hills, but just kind of get themselves in that sort of like zone and just blast themselves up. But,
for sure. Like, if I think about like when I first rode the West Highland Way, like I was aiming for under 12 hours. That was like, because I didn't know anyone. Like I said, I never knew anyone who'd ridden it. And this kind of 12-hour mark. I don't know if you know Ian Nimmo. Like, he's
yeah, I'm familiar with him. I don't know him personally. Though.
Yeah. So like when I was younger, Nimmo was like Scottish mountain bike champion. He was always like a bit of a. He was like total go getter. Like always challenging himself and going to do stuff and like just setting goals and smashing them kind of thing. Real cool guy, and he was like. West Highland Way, like, yeah, you could ride it, I reckon you could do it in 12 hours. So like, I just had this, it's honestly just this number that we'd had a chat about and I was like, right, I'm gonna go try smash 12 hours. And looking back on it, like I think I just had like water in my bottles, you know. It was like I'd water in my bottles and my mum and dad were helping me out do it. I actually rode up to Fort William World Cup. I was working there for Scottish Cycling, running like a stand-up.
Just wanted to save on the fuel, like.
Yeah, just
cycle there instead.
Scottish, yeah. I was like, oh, well, you know, fuck it, I'll just ride up, you know, and like that was an excuse to do it.
Yeah.
So like I was stopping off and like, I remember stopping at like, come off the trail at the bottom of Ben Lomond, meet my mum and dad, have a sandwich and some soup or something, and then get back on the bike and ride off. And at the end of Rannoch Moor on that day, I lay on the ground. I was like, honestly, I lay on the ground for 20 minutes. I was so fucked.
Yeah.
And I just was just not, didn't even consider how much energy I needed to take on.
Yeah.
And also like my pacing was through, like I just basically fucking ride my bike, you know? So like if it's a hard hill, like just smashing up it and then like cruising on the flat bits or whatever, like just not really thinking about it that much. And just totally suffered my way through it. Like, you know, just like, you know, run out of energy, running, like body's basically running on fumes, but I could still ride and I could still finish. So it's like mentally, if you just don't stop, you can keep going, but it's not necessarily the best way to do it. Like I was fucked for days after.
Yeah, okay.
And I think that's something that gets miscommunicated a lot of the time. I grew up through a generation of cycling where it's like no pain, no gain. And you had like, you would look up to people like Lance Armstrong, who, you know, we didn't know he was the biggest drug cheat ever. You would just look at him as this guy and he's like, oh yeah, I just ride my bike for 7 hours every day and I train harder than anyone. I always suffer. And you're like, oh, that's what I need to do. And it's not necessarily so far from the truth, you know.
Yeah.
It's like he's only telling you one part of the story.
Yeah.
You know?
That's interesting.
Yeah, it's pretty nuts. But so you can suffer your way through stuff. It's just not necessarily the best way to do it. But I think that's what mountain bikers, like everyone I know anyway, has been in that situation where you're at the top of you're at the top of Glen Tress and you've run out of food and you've no water with you, and you're just like, fucking, I just need to get home, you know?
It's such a horrible feeling as well, because like literally feel like, it's literally like running out of petrol in your car pretty much.
Yeah, it's grim. Like, you know, it's like, but what's funny as well, like people think, you know, people have a training ride that out or a ride like that and they've suffered really hard and they think, oh yeah, really.
You've gained from that.
Yeah, that's been a really good training ride. Yeah. It's like, nah,
yeah,
it's not what you want to do.
Nah, that's interesting. So to come back to, you've obviously done it. So you've done it two times before.
Yeah.
To go back to like summer this year, I presume you're doing most of your training at home and you're a Wahoo trainer.
Yeah, yeah, getting out on the road where I could. Like, so early lockdown was like short rides. And then as things started to kind of ease, we could ride more. So like go a bit further afield. And yeah, I was putting quite a lot of time on my road bike.
Yeah.
Which was, yeah, I was loving that actually. It was quite kind of cool. Again, like, feel bad saying this about, you know, it's a global pandemic and it's a like a global disaster. But for me, it was almost like, oh man, we're at home and we can.
Yeah, like from a completely selfish perspective, yeah. you are actually having like a good
roads are quiet
good time and stuff.
You know, like roads are quiet, the weather's good. It's like, man, yeah. We can go out and yeah, ride stuff.
I think we've talked about it to pretty much every guest we've had on so far. Obviously, everyone's been cyclists.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, there's that sort of like almost guilt.
We're a privileged bunch.
Yeah.
You know?
Being kind of mindful of what's going on, but then still kind of being able to make the most of a bad situation, I suppose. And yeah, the sort of general sort of feedback from all the riders has been they've been able to ride more.
Yeah, yeah.
And I guess even an extension of that is that cycling's completely exploded, which is quite ironic in that like something that's happened that's driven people to stay at home.
Yeah.
Have actually boosted cycling like insane amounts. So
I think, man, like the times that you're able to get out as well and ride, like it makes you feel so much better, right?
Yeah, yeah.
When the weather was immense, like being able to get out. And I think like being like living in Glasgow, like so like blessed with like you ride for 10 minutes and you're out of the city.
Yeah.
You know, it's like
you're not in the centre of London.
Yeah. Glasgow's got such a nice balance of being like, and you know, you've got all the convenience of being in the city. Like you can go to the supermarket and you can go to cafes and bars,
sure.
Whatever. And then 10 minutes, you know, even like the parks in Glasgow, mm-hmm. Some of the parks you get into and it feels like you're miles away. And we've got like trails, you know, Cathkins, you know, I mean, it's maybe not it's not Whistler, but it's it's pretty
it's
sick.
Still,
it's pretty
still
sick
something
spot.
To get you that sort of little fix. But I think it's interesting, like talk about exercise making you feel better. I think, it's something I've always been quite aware of, that I can basically be in like the most shittest of moods. And then I know if I go out riding, it sort of makes me feel a lot better. I think it's never been more apparent, like, because usually it'd be like you go out to work for a bit or whatever, you do something and you go out riding and it'd be feel good. Whereas at the moment or this summer, it's literally been like you're stuck at home and then just to get out. And then you really notice that sort of like uplift in your mood kind of thing, isn't it? It's pretty.
Yeah, yeah. For me,
I think
it's like
a lot of people have been discovering that.
Yeah, big time. Like, I think like for me, like the hardest mile is the one to get you out the door.
Yeah.
And it's like, once you actually get outside and get kind of into it, it's like, man, this is mint.
You know? Yeah. Like, why did I put this off for like an hour?
Yeah, yeah. Procrastinating all day, like just looking out the window, looking at the weather, like just putting it off. And actually it's like, just get a jacket on and get out there. But I think what's, you know, for a lot of people, a lot of adults as well, like of, you know, maybe rediscovering riding their bike or going out, because riding, yeah, like I guess we're pretty lucky, we never stopped. You know, it's like we've ridden all the way through our teenage years and, you know, as kind of young adults.
Yeah,
but I mean,
for sure.
I was like, I stopped riding when I was 21, you know, stopped riding for like 8 months or something.
Yeah.
And I was getting a job at Scottish Cycling as a coach that got me back into it, into riding. Like,
cool.
You know, I think most people stop, don't they? But maybe don't. It takes longer for them to pick it back up again.
It's funny, cycling's kind of it's an unusual sport that basically everyone actually does when you think about it. And there's not many sports like that, really. Like, obviously, you take your likes of like football or something, which is probably overall bigger. But cycling, in terms of participation, must be just about the biggest sport in the world in terms of participation, if you include like commuting and stuff like that, because almost everyone can ride a bike.
It's it's so varied, isn't it? Like, it's I think like people talk about it almost like swimming, like it's a life skill, you know, like riding a bike. And it is, there's so much variety to riding a bike as well. And what's quite cool is how everyone, like, especially if you think about our friend group, how we all, like, I guess you maybe define yourself as, like, you define yourself as a trail rider. Or like George defines himself as a BMX rider, and I'm a cross country guy. But like, we all ride all different stuff. Like, from you ride a road bike into work, or used to ride your road bike into work, or like, you know, George came on the, you know, rode across to Belgium with me that time. I ride a bit.
You dragged into Belgium.
Yeah, or I'll muck about in the skate park and
yeah.
You know, I think
cool.
it's just having that kind of, I guess, like a bit of an open mind and just trying everything out.
Yeah, for sure. Pretty much anything on two wheels is fun in my book. So one thing I was thinking when I was watching the film is you're obviously going for this record or fastest known time. How clear is it in your mind, like, how much you've got it, if you know what I mean? Like, obviously, there's the time to beat there kind of thing. Like, I don't know whether in terms of, like, using, like, the new technology with, like, the Wahoo stuff, like, are you almost able to kind of, like, make up that route in terms of, like, in your train or whatever and actually almost do that so you really get an idea of whether you're on pace? Because, and I've seen you, like, line up to that with all that camera crew there and stuff, big investment from the sponsors. I was like, I'd be, like, shitting it if there was quite a lot of unknown, because, like, what if you just basically, like, hit the ball at the park in terms of your own performance and just, like, don't beat the time?
Yeah, I wouldn't, like, fill into detail on this. Like, okay. Like, and again, like, the whole thing, you know, I don't really need to ride the West Highland Way again. You know, I've done it a couple of times, but I was like, right, if I'm going to do this, let's do it properly and let's actually see, you know, let's see what I can do. Like, and let's go all in. So, like, the, you know, that's why I hit up Endura. I'm like, right, I want to, you know, I want to drag the Zero helmet, like, which is their, like, super fast, like, aero helmet. So, and then, like, got their fastest race suit on, got aero socks on. I've gone, like, full, like, aerodynamic as much as I can. The bike as well, like, everything on there. I'm like, right, let's just get everything dialed. Let's just, you know, I guess I was looking at all those marginal gains. So if I've got all the marginal gains, I'm like, I might as well, you know, I need to make sure that I'm,
yeah,
do all the basic stuff, like the essential stuff, right? Mm. You know, so stuff like knowing what my, like, how many calories I'm burning an hour and how much of that's fat, how much of that's carbohydrate, like what power output can I sustain for that. So, like, I went, like, I love it. Like, hey, I got right into, like, fitness testing, doing all the stuff at home.
Geeking out.
Yeah.
And, like, do you use, like, that? Like, I'm not familiar with it at all, but I see, obviously, and obviously Wahoo, like, sponsored the video. Can you almost, like, sort of make up the ride?
Yeah,
Can you draw the West Island Way in terms of, like, the...
If I wanted to, I could just click the, take the route off of Strava, drop it in my head unit, the element, the element roam that I've got, fire my bike up on the trainer, and I could ride from start to finish on it.
Okay.
And it would lift my fork up and down when I'm going uphill.
That's
so
insane.
Like, the way it works, like, is the GPX, so the file, if you like, in the head unit, sends a signal to the trainer. So it's like it's called smart trainer. So if I'm pedaling and it's meant to be going uphill, the resistance gets harder on the trainer. That then sends a signal to the climb, like the climb unit in the front. And it rises it to match the resistance, which is getting told from the pitch of the gradient. And then I've even got, like, the fan, like, so the headwind fan is set there. So I can set that up either to go on, you can set it to go on the speed that you're traveling at.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, if I'm riding dead fast downhill, it'll be blowing, like, like a leaf blower in your face kind of thing. Or you can set it to go with your heart rate. So, like, when you're trying harder, it cools you off. Or you can just set it manually.
Okay.
So it's, like, total...
You can't link it up to, like, the current weather on the West Island Way.
Not quite, no.
Probably going to come in, like, the next year, though. I thought that the technology would be pretty good. I didn't realize it was, like, quite to that extent, so that's pretty interesting.
It's so good, man.
Like, as, like, a training tool, that's absolutely mental. Like,
it's like, yeah, it's well good, and it's like, it's proper, because you've got all your numbers as well, like, in front of you. The other thing that's cool, like, so I didn't, like I said at the start, I could do that. I could just drag and drop and do it. But what I was doing instead was I was looking at, like, the, I guess, what are, like, the physical demands of the ride, and then I would basically, when you're training, you basically work on each of the different parts of the jigsaw at once.
Yeah.
You don't try and work. So, like, people always talk about trying to keep training specific, but it's like, actually, you want to break down the specificity and work on the different, almost work on the different elements. So, like, I would do, one of the main things I would do on the kicker at home was that I would, you know, in the morning I'd get up, I would do a fasted ride, or I would do, like, a low carbohydrate ride. And I did fitness testing using a piece of software called Inside, which tells me what's called a fat max, basically the max power output I could sustain with burning fat as the primary fuel source.
Right, okay.
and I would just do fat max intervals. So I'd be riding, they'd do like 10 minutes at fat max or 20 minutes or whatever, and then have a little, and it would just be like a really, really targeted specific session. And then go back up and, you know, have my breakfast or whatever and get carbs back on. So I would do quite a lot of low carb stuff because it's all about fat, basically fat metabolism and becoming fat adapted. Because if you're riding a route like that, you know, if you're riding something for 9 hours, you need to be fat adapted, you know?
Yeah, so that's in terms of you're thinking of the performance aspect of like what your fuel source is during the ride rather than you're not actually trying to cut weight at that time within the training. Or is that
a little bit of both, double-edged sword? More than anything, it was about, you know, I was losing weight over, let's say I was losing weight over the 6 months or something.
Like a conscious thing in terms of like
To optimize like power to weight ratio. You know, if I can get to, it's not a case of if I can get as light as possible, but it's if I can get the right balance and be low body fat. I think I was like 7% body fat when I did the ride.
Okay. So that's not insanely low, is it?
It's not insanely low.
Yeah.
But it's pretty, in terms of being healthy.
Yeah.
It's, you know, if you're a bodybuilder, you go lower. Yeah. But you wouldn't sustain that. But like, 7% body fat, give it like, I was 65 kilos.
Okay.
I'm going to struggle in the maths at the moment, but it's less than 6 kilos of body fat.
So there's basically getting that balance, because if you go below that, you probably start getting weak, I guess.
You get to a point if you drop too low body fat, it's really, really unhealthy.
Okay.
So you need to have the right balance. And again, in terms of nutrition, I've learned so much from Katie, and I think the main thing is like, you know, when you see like Olympic champions and stuff, you imagine how they must live and, you know, what they must do. And the main thing that I picked up from her is that she's just consistent all the time. So she's not doing any fad stuff. She's not doing any crash diet. She's not doing like insane magic training rides or anything, or training sessions. She's just there every day.
Yeah. Okay.
And she consistently rests as well. So it's like, she knows exactly when to back off, when to rest and recover. Cause the main thing is like, again, that often gets forgotten about is the adaptation from your training comes when you rest. It doesn't actually come from smashing yourself. You have to allow yourself the time to recover and adapt, and then your body gets stronger. Yeah.
Which kind of goes against what you're talking about before, that sort of old sort of attitude of cyclists where it's just like no pain, no gain, run yourself into the ground day after day.
Yeah. Overtrained for 18 years or something.
Yeah. Do you now look back at the sort of early part of your career and think, I could have done this a lot different and stuff.
Big time, yeah. I made every mistake in the book.
Yeah.
You know? And it's like, and most of the reasons I make the mistakes were because I was ambitious.
Yeah.
And I wanted to be, and I wanted to achieve, you know? So it's like, fuck, I'll do what needs to be done. Like in terms of smashing myself into the ground, you know? So like, just going out and trying, and one of the things that's interesting for me, like I can ride for hours without eating or drinking that much, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But all that ends up happening is you end up like, I don't know, like binging once you get home.
Yeah,
you know,
for
it's
sure.
Like you end up, and it's not sustainable.
Yeah, got you.
It's quite funny, like training with Katie's brother, John, like he's a awesome rider as well. You want to see the guy eat, man. It's like,
just eats the world.
Just like, I was riding with him the other day and he had like a pack of hobnobs in his pocket and he's just like, hobnob every like 10 minutes.
Yeah.
So much food and like carbohydrates in the bot. Like I was like, one of the biggest things for this West Highland Way was the amount of carbs that I was having. And the main way I was taking it is through fluids. So.
Oh really? I was thinking, that was one thing I was thinking when I was watching the film, because I wasn't sure whether you were getting all your calories through the fluids or whether they just weren't showing the eating parts, but.
Yeah, they didn't really show any eating. So in my bottles, I use a thing called Big Energy, Secret Training Big Energy, 94 grams of carbohydrate in a bottle, or in a 500ml bottle. So like the big bottles were even more. So like that's 400 calories of carbs.
It's like drinking diesel, basically.
It's go weigh out 90 calories of pasta.
Yeah.
Go see how much there is.
Yeah.
It's basically like a bowl of pasta every hour.
Yeah.
It's nuts. Smashing through that, I had like in my top tube bag, like had a little zip bag, and that was full of gels. Gels and bars and that kind of stuff. And so like probably taking a gel an hour as well. So maybe talking like 100, I don't know, like 110 grams of carbs an hour.
Right,
like,
okay.
I think like on the day, my, I think it was 6,000 calories.
Yeah.
Okay. For the ride from start to finish. And I probably
just like 3 days worth basically, isn't it?
Yeah, even like more than that for me. Like my like my basal is about 1,700 calories a day. You can work it out, like, yeah, there's calculators online and all the rest of it. But yeah, like, so it's, you know, a lot of the kind of general people say it's 2,500 calories a day for a for an average man.
Yeah.
I'm clearly not an average man. but yeah, so like, yeah, just a lot of energy.
Yeah.
A whole lot, like, and carb loading the day before, like pasta, pizza, all that kind of stuff. Like, and not just the day before, but like talking for days, like eating hunters and hunters of food.
Yeah, I was gonna say, like, it was one thing to ask is like, what do you do in terms of like the prep? Like, because it's not just about getting the calories in the day. Like, did you have it kind of meticulously planned in terms of like what you do? Like 3 days ahead, 2 days ahead kind of thing.
One of the kind of interesting things that's quite cool is Katie got me on this as well, but a sleep schedule.
Okay.
So we're planning to start the ride at maybe 6:30 in the morning. Between 6:30 and 7, we were thinking like just basically as soon as it got light enough, really. Mm-hmm. So I don't know, like I live about half an hour away from the start, and you got all the faff to, you know, get kit on and get the bike ready and all that kind of stuff. So let's say you're starting at 6:30, need to be there at 5:30, need to leave the house at 5:00 in the morning, you need to get up 4:00, let's say. So basically for over a period of about 2 weeks, just started to like go to bed half an hour earlier each day and get used to waking up stupid early.
Like, so that just becomes your new morning.
Yeah, so like it kind of changes your what do you call it, like circadian rhythm or something like that. Basically your sleep pattern, so that you're able to, you're able to go for it on the day, you know. But like in terms of my routine and it going into it, I think it was probably the most out of routine I was the entire time, because partly just because of the getting everything ready. Mm-hmm. You know, so like in the lead up, like let's say when I took it to like cut and stuff, and we were like, right, well, this is the 2 weeks that we're going to look to do. And we're trying to get everything organized. So we've got like a crew of like, we basically had, two crews running, two crews of two people running, on different parts of the journey. Plus we had drone op and stills photographer and producer. So like there was stuff like needed to organize a boat for Loch Lomond. So we had a boat run, like getting everyone up and getting shots and making sure that they could, because I guess the logistics of getting around is pretty stressy. So I was like, right, 2 weeks, we're going to go these 2 weeks in September, thinking like weather in September is normally dialed, you know, we'll go with that. So identified that. And then we had, we're getting closer and closer to that. So we're like maybe a week out of that. I'm looking at the weather forecast and it's total dog shit.
It's classic pouring. Storm.
Yeah, it's like pouring rain. Like it was hurricane season or something, like in the Atlantic. And it's just, yeah, it was pouring rain. And I'm just like, Jesus Christ, this is hellish. And I'm just, yeah, I'm literally checking the weather every day. And like the tail end of the week started to look like it was going to be sunny, but it'd been pouring rain. So I'm like, we need a couple of days to like hopefully try and dry the trail out a bit, because otherwise it's going to be slow.
Cool.
And so we had the couple of days where it was looking dry, and then Friday looked, it was gleaming, like real nice weather, but the wind forecast wasn't good. It was kind of low wind, but it was
not going the right direction.
Yeah, it was going the total wrong direction. So I'm like, fuck. So we're like dialing that in. Obviously talked about, got one-off, like total one-off bespoke bike arriving. It's getting held up with COVID shit, and I'm like, Jesus. So like the bike doesn't arrive until, so I'd identified the 2 weeks, so Monday was the first day that of when I might have done the attempt. The bike didn't arrive until the Tuesday.
Oh really?
Yeah. And I got out of the box and I was like, oh man, I need to like tune it up, get it like set up to me, like, so I had to change the handlebars. And yeah, I run like proper narrow bars and you chop them. So these 780 wide bars come out and I'm like, what the hell? So switching my bars over, fitting the Kush core, like all that kind of stuff. And then the next day was, so that was a day that was meant to be training. I had like a like kind of going through like a taper, we'll call it.
Okay.
To get ready for it. So like start to like pull out some of the training time, like the volume, if you call it, like
just to kind of start the bike, just to kind of
freshen up a bit. But you still need to keep in like these kind of intense efforts and you know, keep training to stay tuned up. So I missed a total day of training there. Next day we were filming at Cathkin, doing the bike check and stuff. So I was up there with Andre. And then I was running errands because like stuff like I needed a spare brake rotor, a different brake rotor for a wheel. So I'm like driving around, like trying to get stuff. I was picking stuff up from Enduro. Just like
the opposite of what you need to be doing.
Absolutely. Yeah. So the last week where you're wanting to get everything perfect was just all over the shop. Wasn't really sleeping. You know, just because I was nervous and like there was just loads of pressure. And then the day before, so I just got the new bike and I'm like, this bike's amazing, but I've not ridden it on, you know, riding it at Cathkin is not the same as riding it on the West Highland Way, right?
So yeah,
like,
for sure.
Drive up to Drummen at like 6 a.m. the day before and I'm like, I'll do a lap and ride Connacht Hill, which is pretty, you know, pretty good representation of the toughest stuff, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm out and I'm like, buzzing, feeling like real good in the bike. The bike's amazing. And I get to top of Connacht Hill and just start, you know, rallying down it. Got a dropper on, got this new fork on it, like a Sid Ultimate with 110mm and like beefier stanchions. So I just feel like so confident on the bike. I just riding so fast that I just smash my back wheel and get a flat.
Okay.
And I'm like, Jesus. So like, didn't have a, you know, basically plugged it. I'd like, he's like a Dyna plug, like plug the hole up, get down the hill, ride back in, and I'm like, right, I need, you know, I didn't have a spare tire at home, like, and these are like pretty, they're not the kind of tires you can just walk into
a bike shop
and pick up, and I'm like, oh, fuck. So I'm speaking to Rob at Conti, and like, what, you know, what should I do? I've got like, you know, I had another tire that was, I'd been, you know, used a fair bit, and I'm like, fired that on. But all I was thinking about like was fuck, puncture in Connacht Hill or anywhere. Like, you know, I'd punctured on a recce ride just north of Kinlochleven as well, like, which is the last kind of section, like 20K to the finish. And it was just, again, it was on like a rocky road, like a gravel road.
Mm-hmm.
Just one of those things, like just going a bit too fast and just blew it out.
Yeah, so you're just trying to get that balance basically the whole time about basically keeping the speed up, but not like, getting a mechanical.
And talking puncture, like people, you know, everyone's going like, oh, just run heavier tires. Like, why you running heavier? You know, why run those tires? And I'm like, the tires aren't the problem. The tires are meant, like.
Yeah.
I've been using them for years. It's just really, really rough trail. Like the e-bikes, so the crew on the e-bikes had 6 punctures in one day.
Oh, really?
Trying to film, all just riding up and down. So it's like, and they're running like big case and tires as well. It's just, they're just sharp rocks. And if you're out for 9 hours, the probability of getting a puncture gets...
It's a lot of rocks to go over. It's pretty high. A lot of sharp rocks.
And you could run a heavier tire, but to run a... You had the protection casing from Conti on there, which is, again... It's,
yeah, and you're riding Cushcore as well.
And Cushcore and loads of sealant. So everything, I'm doing everything right. To go up a tire case, and you would have to be on like an enduro tire or something like that.
And then over the course of like be, 9 hours, it's going to just like slow you down basically.
Yeah, it's not the tool for the job, you know. It's like, like rotation weight's pretty
significant.
Yeah, significant. And then also like the rolling resistance as well. Like the Race Kings that I was running are so fast, like, but it's like you just got to manage it because for whatever the 95, 96 miles, there's maybe only like 10 miles of that, which you're like, is really gnarly. Like you,
So the rest of it.
The rest of it's like pretty fast going, like you maybe gravel roads or like really, nice kind of smooth single track or all that stuff. And then you've got like these key sections, which are just mental, like, you know, they're like enduro or downhill tracks, you know, it's proper, you know.
That's cool. One thing, we didn't mention was, which was quite a key part of the film, was you obviously, we talked about the targets and times and stuff like that.
Yeah.
You had this time in mind, which was from, who's the guy that...
Keith Forsyth did a 10 hours and 27 minutes in 2015. I knew Gary was going for it and turned out he goes for it and absolutely smashes it. Like,
and he takes it from where to what? From what to...
So it went from 10 hours and 27 minutes to 9 hours and 28.
Right, okay. So it's not just
59 minutes. Yeah,
10%, you know? Basically.
Absolutely smashes it out the flipping ballpark, you know. And he's got the tools, you know, to go fast. And he smashed this time. And I was like, Jesus.
Yeah, do you remember where you were when you sort of, did someone give you a text or you were like, Gary's just taking an hour off this record? Like,
Stu texted me a screenshot of this.
So Stu's obviously the executive producer of the film from Cut Media.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Who I imagine is a massive part of putting the whole thing together.
Yeah.
So he finds out about it.
And Stu and Gary like go way back to motorbike trials days and that kind of stuff. So he sent me just a screenshot and he was just like...
He's just was it the Strava?
Yeah, just the the Strava and the record. And he's like... And then Enduro messaged me and be like... I know you're talking about going under 10 hours, but I've just seen Gary McDonald's just gone 9:28. Does this change your plans at all? And I'm just like, I was actually buzzing. I was like, this is sick. Cause,
and how far out are you from your, I guess you don't
six
know.
Weeks, exactly. I think.
Okay. So you're 6 weeks.
6 weeks.
Did it change anything? Or was it a case of just like carry on? You're always going for the fastest time you could do rather than like a specific target. So I guess it doesn't change your, or did it actually kind of...
I didn't change anything. And that was kind of... That gave me a bit of confidence because I was sat there and I was going, right, well, there's nothing I'm going to do differently. And I looked at his ride and I kind of was like, well, I wouldn't... That's not how I would ride it. Kind of looking at certainly...
In terms of the pacing of it? Or?
In terms of pacing, yeah. In terms of like just looking at a heart rate trace, like he was like, you know, in my opinion, probably went a bit too hard, which is natural. It's normal to do. Like if you're going for a time, you know, you're going to go hard. Eh?
Yeah. Like you say, it's counterintuitive.
So like, and obviously I'm doing a bit of, a bit of flipping in-depth planning. So, and it didn't change anything. I just saw it and I was like, well, let's give this a crack.
So Gary's obviously set that time. That becomes the new sort of like official target. The
only
you've probably got you kind of maybe had a different target in your mind.
Yeah.
Do you then, when you sort of embark on, when you start to obviously see it in the film, do you have like these sort of like markers in your mind or even written down of like where you need to be? So like you've talked about Connacht Hill, which you obviously talked about the puncture risk.
Yeah.
I think in the film you got through that without a puncture. Are you then like after that's done, are you kind of, or is it your coach that's been doing, that's obviously following the sport vehicle?
Me, I'm self-coached.
Okay, self-coached, right. But you obviously had a support group.
Yeah, yeah.
Are you basically like looking at, right, I need to be here at this time, I need to be there at that time?
Yeah, I had a bit of an idea. James McCallum, who I think kind of comes across a little bit like my coach in the film. Like, yeah. So I'd given Jambo and James and my parents, I had like a bit of a schedule.
Yeah.
Like, and kind of the schedule was also partly for the film crew, so they know where they need to be for what kind of time. So I got a bit of an idea of what my schedule is going to be, and I'd taken that off of Gary's record, you know, right, kind of just had a little bit of an idea and being like, right.
Yeah, in the film when he's saying, oh, you're 5 minutes up or that, they're referring to Gary's time.
Yeah.
That's not a different target. That's
cool. And like in terms of starting, you kind of asked before about like how confident was I that I could do it. I was... Like barring incidents, I was 100% confident I could do it.
Yeah, you know? I remember you saying that the start of the film, you were most stressed about getting mechanical because I guess that stood as like the sort of biggest obstacle.
Mechanical and conditions, you know, wind conditions and mechanical was probably the biggest.
Even with that in mind, did you kind of always know that you were on pace essentially to beat the fastest known time, which is obviously Gary McDonald? Or was there a time where you were maybe a little bit behind and need to get it?
I mean, within the first hour, I was 10 minutes up.
Okay.
And again, I think that was, a lot of that was just on, you know, I think partly riding with a power meter, like, helped. So, like, when it was, like, easy and fast, I would go fast. Like, if it was, like, pretty easy, I'd be doing, like, 25 miles an hour along like tarmac or flat ground or whatever. And if it went steep, I was, like, backing it right off.
Right, okay.
You know, like I was riding, you know, because it's really easy to just go put your power through the roof and kind of smash up a hill.
Yeah, and it might not actually translate to much time.
Yeah, and it catches up on you later, you know. It's like it's effectively a time trial.
Yeah.
So if you're racing with other people, you might have to smash it up the hill because you need to stay with the group. But if you're on your own, you just spin up it.
Just keep your mind in the big picture.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And trying, like, it's really hard because you're riding up this hill, like, in bottom gear. try to go as slowly as you can. And you're like, man, I'm meant to be going fast here. Like,
yeah.
But you just got to have confidence in that kind of confidence in that kind of trust the process, yeah. You know? So I got to the top of Connick Hill and yeah, like 10 minutes up. And I kind of knew that I would be on that. And I think, again, like my advantage of being, I know that part of the route quite well because it's close to home. And then by Inversnaid, I kind of knew where I was going to be on time. And I was pretty much perfect pace to what I'd previously done.
Cool.
You know, and I was setting my kind of schedule off of that. You know, you're talking within seconds, you know. Mm-hmm.
Was it not until the puncture that was like your sort of first sort of
yeah, like when I punctured sort of like, well when I punctured yeah. I knew I had time and the headwind on Rannoch Moor cost me 10 minutes.
Right, okay.
But when I got to the end of Rannoch Moor, I think I was still maybe like 15 or 20 minutes ahead of Gary's benchmark. Okay.
I see.
And at the top of the Devil's Staircase, I think it was 25 minutes ahead.
Okay.
So I had 25 minutes in hand, rode down like the gravel. You know, I don't know if you've ever ridden down into Kinloch, but it's like quite a steep kind of, it's like a single tracky kind of footpath off the top of the Devil's Staircase. And then you join like a kind of double track, which is like real rocky.
Right.
Like I would call it a gravel road, but it kind of does it and doesn't really sum it up well, you know. So it's like coming down there on a flat, and again like riding past walkers, and again just thinking they must be like, yeah. What the hell is this guy doing? And it was like it was about 10 or 15 minutes I rode a flat for down the hill. Lost a bit of time, but not tons. And then obviously had to stop and do that. So when I set off from there, let's say I think I was maybe still had 20, 18 minutes in hand. And that's when I went into limp mode. Like I rode up out of Kinloch and I was like, all I was thinking about was, man, I'm flipping, that headwind was hellish. And man, that if I had a puncture and that's killed my time. And all I was caring about was going as fast as I could go.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like I say, on the military road to Fort William is where I punctured previously. The tire that I'd put on, like, was gassed up pretty hard as well. And I was just like, honestly, like, just not limping, but just like cruising along there, like being like, just do not puncture. Like, if you get a flat here, that's, you know, and if it was like another flat, if it was another like catastrophic flat, it could have really.
Would have stopped me from taking it,
you know. So I'm like bumbling along, and then like, as you've seen the film, like with James McCallum, with his flipping rallying speech.
Yeah, I think that was like one of the standout moments of the film. Actually, it's like you get a proper like, all right, buzz off that bit where he's literally like running it, like, and it kind of hits home the fact that it. Well, so obviously not to take away from your achievement, it is an individual achievement, but it kind of hits home the fact that it's a massive team effort.
Oh yeah, for sure. And like,
obviously, without those guys, it wouldn't be possible. But
yeah, well,
definitely did see like you were having like a little bit of a lull,
with the punch and stuff,
and then that seemed to just like kind of pick you right back up. With like, how long was there to go after that little bit?
Probably within the last hour, you know, maybe I don't know, 10 miles or something. Yeah. I can't really think. But the reason they were there was like I want to have a wheel at the end, like just in case I get another flat.
Right.
Like,
okay.
You go at the end of there and it's like at Lundavra. It's a proper pain in the neck to get to.
Yeah, okay.
It's like you have to drive out Fort William up this long road. And actually, I only knew it was there because I've ridden out of there in a no-fuss event, Tour de Ben Nevis, a couple of years ago, with Gary McDonald won.
Very fitting.
So we rode out of that. And so I knew you could get to there from that. So I was like, you guys get there.
That's cool. It's definitely
so funny, like, and Jambo Wright as well needs some credit in this as well. He was walking away up the hill to hand me a bottle, and Hank, he had the spare wheels as well. One of the funniest bits with that was as we got to Tin Drum, and I was, so this is a way bit further down, like previously in the ride, as I got to Tin Drum, Jambo, you know Jambo, he stood in the main road like that, stopping traffic cars. And stopping like lorries and that, and I was just like, you can't do that.
Fuck it.
Gallus by name, eh? Gallus by nature.
Nah, it's class. Yeah. So you obviously in the film, which I encourage people to go and watch, you cross the line and it's maybe not quite the reaction people might be quite expecting for someone who's just broken or set the fastest known time.
Yeah.
What was that sort of emotions running through your mind when you do cross that line? Because you do seem a little bit...
Yeah, deflated. Depleted. Yeah, yeah. I'm just like, I think like just deflated it sums it up quite nicely with the flat tire and stuff. I think I was just overthinking things riding into the finish. You know, I was worrying more about, it was getting to that end of like the pressure that I'd been under, like really quite stressed out and worrying quite a lot about the whole ride and actually being able to deliver on it. Like it's... I kind of say like it's like a career highlight for me to make a film like this.
Yeah.
And it might sound, I don't know if it maybe sounds a bit kind of, I don't know, like, you know, I should be more interested in the ride and the setting of the time. But to make the film was like, I've never done that before. I've never been a part of a project anywhere near as
big an achievement as the setting of the time itself.
Yeah, and I've always had ideas. Like I've always wanted to do, like I talked about making the film when I first did it. Like my dad's like,
yeah, which was really cool to see that footage.
Yeah,
that you
it was
guys,
cool
like,
to have
back
it.
In,
like. And like, you know, to kind of piece that stuff together and put it out. And like, I was, for a long time as well, like I was, you know, cross-country mountain biking didn't really get as big a coverage as a lot of, you know, certainly in the UK, like downhill's by far and away, like the inspiration for a lot of people to ride. And, you know, I always wanted to like, you know, be part of a project to kind of make cross country riding and endurance stuff look good and actually give some coverage, you know. Yeah. I was like, always like my goal always was to be a professional bike rider.
Yeah.
You know, so to be finally be a part and do something like that, like a real legit kind of project with big partners and
yeah, for sure. Like I think like that's almost overlooked in terms of achievements, like just pulling that together with the likes of Cut Media and to be working with those guys, Santa Cruz, and
it's all kind of come together over a number of years. Like I always try and work with brands that I'm into, you know. Like it's like, you know, it's not like it's about money or anything like that. I always just want to try and work with people that I, you know, and represent brands that I think are that I kind of believe in and hopefully believe in me. So it's really cool to have that. And like Wahoo need a lot of credit in this one because Louis Quinton from Wahoo is one of the marketing guys who's really, you know, without his support, this wouldn't have happened.
Pretty cool.
It's pretty cool to see someone like Wahoo, which is by their sort of business is obviously indoor, like stationary bikes. It's quite cool to see them back a project on a real bike. But obviously... still showcases their products in terms of the preparation, but
for
the actual ride itself. Like obviously, they have
the GPS
and stuff.
Yeah, and the funny thing is like the ticker heart rate monitor is one of the things. So the whole reason I've ever used the only reason I've ever used Wahoo stuff was like 5 years ago, maybe 6 years ago, when I was working at dirt school down in Peebles, and I was riding quite a lot with the base course, and I didn't have a GPS or a heart rate monitor or that, but I had Strava on my phone. Yep. So I would like, you know, if I was riding, I was like, I want to kind of track my fitness. You know, I was quite into staying fit for racing, and I'm, you know, basically fire up Strava, and I was like, I need a heart rate monitor for this. And I'm like, Wahoo made this ticker heart rate strap that was Bluetooth, it would sync with phones, it would sync with head units, and just dead versatile. It looked really like workable, so I bought one of these, got sent over like as a legit customer, like no discount, no nothing, just bought one.
Cool.
And started using that, and then when George and I started planning for this the bike back to Belgium trip we did a couple of years ago, I was like, oh, I need a GPS head unit to, you know, to have the maps on and to be able to follow and figure out where I'm going to go. So I end up like hitting this guy Louis up, like just totally slid into the DMs and be like, hey man, this is what I'm planning, you know.
Yeah.
Really like it if you supported me with something, and you know, this is what I'm gonna be doing, and told him a little bit about it. And he's like, sure. Sent me up like a GPS, like an element bolt, and rode with that for a bit, and then I wrote sorry, I did the event, got a decent bit of coverage off the back of it, yeah. and then continued to use it. And then just things started to, you started using the kicker.
Yeah.
Which is their smart trainer, which is makes life so much more, your training so much more convenient when you're training and around work. And
which I think so many stuff. People must have utilized this year.
Oh, like, man, I think
they've probably been having an absolute birthday.
They couldn't make enough of them, man. Yeah. It was like, I think they've, a lot of people were after indoor trainers and the kicker, the thing that I like about it is they're all pretty self-explanatory and straightforward to use. You know, it's like pretty high tech pieces of kit, but dead easy to use. And then, they've supported me tons. But it all started off of pretty small, just as a, I think everyone that's involved in it, I've started as a customer and moved on.
That's cool. At least it's in natural. It's like same with Santa Cruz. You've always been riding Santa Cruz bikes for years.
Yeah.
So it's cool that they backed the project as well. So,
yeah.
And really, that bike just looks like, I'm no cross country expert or whatever, but sick. It definitely looked like the right tool for the job.
Yeah. So sick. Yeah. Like the Santa Cruz link came through Chris Ball and Andy Barlow at Durant School. We were using Santa Cruz, once I was working there and still were buying the bikes, to use, but we had a real good relationship with Santa Cruz UK and Jungle, and the bikes are sick, It's like, I'm like a total super fan. Yeah, still a super fan of all that stuff. Steve Pete fanboy, big thing, I think pretty much, I've always been riding, I never had a GT, but I always rode an Orange when I was a kid, when Petey was riding Orange, and then
it's class.
He's in the Santa Cruz now, and I'm into the bikes for sure.
Sweet. So you've obviously been fairly vocal in the past in terms of mental health, and maybe struggling with depression at different times in your life. How much of a sort of better headspace do you think you're in when you do have a big challenge like the West Highland Way in the horizon compared to maybe when you're on the other side of it?
Yeah.
I.e. at the moment, I know myself personally, if I've got something to aim for, whether it's work or personal, you're just going to be in a sort of happier place because you've got something to do. You have direction.
Definitely. I really struggle with having a sense of purpose or self-worth. Mm-hmm. And spending that, once you do have something that you're working towards and you've got support, and I think one thing I really like is working as part of a team, if it's a team of filmmakers or if it's a team whatever, a huge thing was training with Katie, having somebody to train with every day.
That makes such a massive difference.
What a difference. It even goes to the same as when I was riding BMX or riding skate park, I'll go ride with Ali or Deansy or George or whoever. There would always be someone to ride with, and I'd be working towards something, and it would always just be someone by my side. I'm kind of I struggle a little bit with self-motivation. Mm-hmm. And again, but the feeling that I had working towards this, it was I'm doing something, and it's it's real good. I listened to a few of the podcasts before and talking about post-event blues.
Yeah.
And man, after the West Highland Way was real struggle,
right?
Especially not being able to talk about it, but to be basically gotten as fit as I've ever been. I've worked really hard, I've set out to do something, and I've managed to do it. And then it was I kind of say it in the interview, what's next? Need something to, not necessarily need something, but enjoy to have something to train on, because even off the back of that, maybe need a lull to kind of recover and take your foot off the gas a little bit. You can't be 100% all the time. If you're I think it was Cade said that the other day, actually, you can't or maybe Matt Walker, I can't remember, but you can't switch it on if you don't switch off, kind of thing.
For sure.
Having a bit of an off season.
It's just hard to get that balance, isn't it? Because I find sometimes what we talked about before, you're kind of almost looking forward to it being over.
Yeah.
And you think you're going to get this amazing feeling, and it is good, but it's maybe not quite as good as you're maybe hoping it or expecting it to be, and it can kind of knock you for six a little bit.
Yeah, the process is almost the better part, the training for it and just having the reason to kind of show up, almost the best bit. And then one of the clips that got cut from the film was Stu asked me, how does it feel now, how do you feel to have it done? And I'm I'm just glad it's over. At that moment, that probably was the case, because again I don't deal well with pressure.
Yeah, okay.
Like my coping mechanisms for dealing with pressure are not very good. or they're certainly the ones that I adapted or adopted for a long time. So yeah. Like if I'm under pressure or feel like something's not going well, I'll just be like, look the other way and just like head in the sand, ignore it. Like, you know, just try and do that. And obviously you got to face your problems, right? Mm-hmm. You got to just deal with it. And I've never really been that good at that. Which, yeah, it's like, there's a big mental battle, isn't there?
Yeah.
In terms of...
I think everyone's dealing with it ongoing.
Everyone, yeah. I mean, it's a part of life, isn't it? It's trying to manage it and understand how to, you know, how to deal and cope with these things, you know. You know, how to manage with anxiety or low moods or whatever, you know. It's like, I heard an interest... What, I'm going to get this wrong. But it was a psychologist... I was saying this in it. It was your brain doesn't care if you're happy. Your brain cares if you're safe.
Yeah.
That's all it cares about. So it's like when you've got that sense of anxiety or you're feeling like
it's
that.
It's sensing danger essentially, isn't it? Even though it's not necessarily danger.
Yeah. But it's just what you maybe perceive to be danger and it just freaks you out and you get that sense of anxiety or that you just.
And I guess, your brain's sort of misinterpreting the pressure that you're putting yourself on to do that for actual danger.
I used to just call that stress.
Yeah.
I'd be like, oh, I feel stressed. But actually it was like an absolute feeling of anxiety or sense of dread, you know? Yeah. And it's like, just try to strike the balance with it. And it's always been, it's weird because like I love riding my bike and I love racing, but the stress or the anxiety or the pressure that it puts you under can be really, really hard to deal with.
Is that something... you've maybe taken from Katie, because I know we discussed this before. Katie's obviously, she's an Olympian world champion cyclist. She's in the British cycling program, who I'm not sure if he still is, but their sort of lead sports psychologist is Dr. Steve Peters, who's written The Chimp Paradox, which is that whole premise of that book is basically what you're talking about. It's like that sort of primal, there's like sort of chimp inside you, basically sensing danger. When it's maybe not actually there and kind of just making you super stressed.
Yeah.
It's all about kind of like recognizing that and trying to sort of rationalize those feelings.
Definitely, you know, living with Katie, you see the way that she goes about her life and her work and how committed she is and how hard she trains. I think that maybe something that doesn't necessarily come across with when people are watching Katie compete. Because she just seems to be like untouchable and invincible, you know. Yeah. She rocks.
We never
up,
see what's
it.
Going on behind the scenes, do you?
Yeah, you don't see the 12 months leading into it where she's, you know, training super hard. Like she's so consistent, and she doesn't really shout about it either. So
yeah,
you know, she doesn't do like gym selfies or like, you know, out on the road with your pictures and all that.
Yeah, she's just quietly doing her thing.
She does it, you know. She goes out and she does it. She
must be pretty sort of inspiring for yourself to see the way she operates.
Big time. Yeah, let's go. I mean. In one of the interviews, I said, like, you can't ask for a better training partner. Mm-hmm. It's like the training partner I've always wanted, you know?
Yeah.
Like, although we're like, you know, she's training for a 4-minute long track event.
I'm training for a nine-hour mountain bike ride.
But like, there's so many things that just kind of worked, that worked kind of together, and just getting that consistency in that routine. But talking about like, kind of, you were talking about psychologists and chimp paradox and all that kind of stuff. I think someone that I really take loads about psychology from was Andy Barlow and Chris Ball when I was working at Dirt School. Okay. You know, and I was actually talking about more like event specific stuff and that working with riders and learning about, you're especially working with downhill riders, you know, head game's massive, you know, and the biggest mistake people make, I reckon, when they race downhill is they try and go too fast in the wrong places because they're like, I'm on the clock, I need to go fast.
Yeah.
So it's trying to, I remember as well, like the kind of stuff that Steve Peters talks about is like, have confidence in what you've done. Like, you know, when the negative thought comes in, displace it with a positive.
Because you always have to be thinking of something, basically. Yeah, you can't try and just to say, forget about it, doesn't work.
Yeah. I'm going to drop a pretty big name here, but like with Chris Hoy, like I raced, I never raced Chris Hoy, but we were on the same Scotland team 2006 when I raced in Melbourne Commonwealth Games. And Chris was there as Olympic kilo champion. And that was as he's riding the kilo. So the kilo is a 1 kilometer time trial in the velodrome. And I'm not sure if he was defending world champion or what the state was at the time, but he was basically the last person to go off. And all the riders before him were like, breaking the world record. And
which
he
I guess
sat
is
there.
Like the same as what happened to you, kind of thing.
He's got minutes to deal with it, you know, and he's like sat there and just being like, you know, got to get up. And you know, if you ever speak to Chris, like, he's just one of the, like, most solid guys, you know, like, his mindset's pretty flipping bulletproof, you know? And, you know, I guess the, you know, I displaced that thought, like, these people are setting world records, but he's like, well, if I look back on it, I've put in all this work. Mm-hmm. I'm in the best shape I've ever been.
Yeah.
You know, there's nothing I can do about what they've done. I'm going to just get up there and I'm going to ride my own race.
Yeah. And it was Steve Pearce. I think, interestingly, it is actually Steve Pearce who had equipped him with those tools to deal with that, because he was probably working with him like on a sort of weekly basis.
Yeah, like with the skill set or the mechanisms to adopt to do that. And that's like the same thing for downhill riders. Like, Reese was talking about it when he was on, he was just loving it. He was just feeling great on the bike, you know, and he was very confident, and you could see everyone around him, you know, their confidence wasn't there, and he had it.
And it has that sort of, that's just that snowball effect, isn't it? Like, once it kind of starts going, you're then just on the right path. And
yeah, and like, I think Reese said it on the podcast with you, when you asked him about his run, tell us about your run. And he was like, actually, it was...
Don't remember it.
Yeah, well, I think it was more like he said, like, it was, felt normal. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, it was like he got to that point where he was just right on the knife edge, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
He had the, you know, I guess I'm going to steal another Barlow one here, but like the key to like confidence is control. Like, if you're out of control, you know, I guess you can... You know, like, even though Reese maybe looked out of control, he felt like he knew it, you know, he was quite comfortable with it.
Yeah, as control as you could be on that track, I guess.
Yeah, he was comfortable with it, you know.
Nah, and I think, I think the key thing is with downhill and many other things, it's about being able to do it at kind of 95%, which is maybe not the right term, but if you're doing it, if you're too loose with it, like, it's unsustainable and you won't be able to do it week in, week out. So,
really common thing with riders is, when you're on if you're on a race run or something, it's like, especially for like working with like amateur or like enthusiast kind of weekend warrior, like normal riders who race maybe six times a year, you know, generally what happens is they turn up on the start line and they try and ride way faster than they've ridden all year.
Yeah. Okay.
They go, well, this is a race, I've got to go faster now. And it's like,
that's all you want to do.
Yeah. It just makes you make a load of mistakes, or you crash, or you make a mistake on the run and then you go, oh man, like, I've made that mistake, I need to catch that time up. And it's like, well, the reason you made the mistake is you were going too fast. Yeah. Like, you got to slow down, just chill.
Yeah, it's just a big balancing act, isn't it?
Yeah, and that's like with the, kind of talked earlier about training, it's like you've got to work, you figure out what are the different pieces of the jigsaw and put them together. And you know, the big one's going to be consistency, you know, and actually understanding your pacing. So whether it's pacing the West Highland Way, or if it's pacing Spooky Woods, you know, or like a downhill run or whatever, it's, you got to strike the right kind of balance. If you go too fast, you're doing it wrong.
We obviously talked about generally having a sort of better mental sort of state when you've got a challenge or a project on the horizon. Do you have any, you obviously briefly talked about making a little bit of a comeback to cross country racing, have you got any more sort of challenge based stuff on the sort of, in the planning phases? Like, I know obviously Mark Bowman has gone around the world and done all sorts of, is that the sort of thing that you'd ever be tempted to get involved in?
I never say never, but I don't think so.
Would you say physiologically, is there, would you say you're suited to like the sort of length of what the West Highland Way is? Because I know like Mark Beaumont's a big guy. I don't know whether that is good for that or not, but
I think like physiologically is an interesting one. So like basically like, I mean, like, I've kind of talked about this with Katie before, like, so like aerobically, you know, like my aerobic engine's pretty well trained and it's there's definitely a bit of potential there, like, so like my VO2 max can get pretty high with training. And then it's a case of just actually tailoring that and understanding how to pace certain efforts.
Yeah.
So like, it's the same. So I'm never saying I'm going to be an amazing like pursuit rider, which is like a 4-minute event, but I probably got the physiological like tools if you like to be okay at it, you know, to be pretty good at it. But I guess I'm probably more tailored to longer endurance events. And again, it takes a bit of training to go with it. So actually some of the like hour long races are real good for me, like cyclocross. I always really liked cyclocross. But again, it's just about, I guess if you're wanting to do something, for me, if wanting to do something like that, is just looking at the event demands and training towards that, figuring out what your weakness is and tuning that up. But I'm never going to be a sprinter, an out and out sprinter, like even a road sprinter. I would, I'm not going to bother anyone, but quite light and go uphill pretty fast. Yeah. So like I always wanted to be a downhill rider.
That's the West Highland way and things like, and terrain like that's probably the sort of thing that fits you perfectly, because you've got the sort of aerobic capabilities and fitness to do it, but then you've also got the mountain bike skills to like still make up time and stuff on the on the climb down the descent.
Yeah, I'm not like super explosive, which I think could probably, I mean, maybe get a bit old for training it now, like to make a complete change in physiology, but or like in terms of makeup, but you know, it does come with training. But yeah, generally power to weight kind of stuff is going to be like aerobic power to weight. So 5 minutes, 20 minutes are probably my, like in terms of my, so like when I do fitness tests and you test over different durations, and like my 5 and my 20 minute power is pretty good. Cool. Certainly for my weight.
Sweet. So you just, at the moment, you're just kind of enjoying a little bit of being able to kind of let yourself go a little bit and not be so strict on the diets and the training
To be honest, I've been ticking over, like once I finished the West Highland way, I was like, man, what am I going to do? But I was like sat there and like the best, like super fit. So I was like, sod it. I just,
you don't want to just like undo all the hard work.
I did a week of Zwift racing. So like, I don't know if you're familiar with Zwift, but like the online, like you fire up the kicker, smart trainer, and fire up Zwift and race. And I just did like a Zwift race every day just for something to do. And like was kind of competitive in that, like, which was pretty fun. Like it kind of kept me riding hard and not really having to think about it. I don't really want to get sucked into the whole FKT thing. I don't want to always,
don't want that to become your thing.
Yeah, sometimes I want to just go out and ride it and just like actually stop and not just be thinking about the time, you know, just go out and enjoy it and kind of do part of the adventure. Really keen on the Annapurna circuit in Nepal.
Okay.
I think that'd be sick. A guy, Corey Wallace from Canada, has a record for riding that. It's like under 24 hours. He's 24-hour world champion. I've raced with him before in the past. He's a pretty sound guy, like, and gnarly dude. Yeah. But you can ride Annapurna circuit. You know, it could be cool to even do it over a couple of days and stop at the monasteries or whatever, tea huts, and chill.
That'd be cool. Oh, well, plenty to look forward to. If you're ever wanting somebody to join you, one of them, let me know. But I'll probably be doing it on an e-bike and not the regular bike.
Yeah, for sure.
But nah, it's class. We've been speaking for quite a while now, so we'll probably call it a day there.
Yeah.
Where should people find the film?
The film is on Wahoo's YouTube channel. Okay, so Wahoo Fitness on YouTube. We've all kind of shouted about it a fair bit. So like Santa Cruz have shared it with Cut Media, myself. It's on Pink Bike. We had some great support, good features on Pink Bike.
Yeah, feedback's been great. So yeah, if you guys haven't watched it, be sure to go and check it out. And social media wise, where best to get you?
All the usual places are Instagram, like just Rab Wardell, all one word. That's pretty much it.
Keep following your next adventures in Nepal. Thanks again for coming on, and hopefully go and have a little ride now.
Yeah, cool. Get do some stunts in the barn.
Yeah, cheers, dude.
Cheers, man. Thank you.